Hello, board gamers, and welcome back to Not Board Gaming. I'm your host, I'm Mark. Now, in today's episode, we are going to be reviewing Dune House Secrets from Portal Games. That's right, Dune House Secrets. It's their latest release, and it's been released to tie in with the big tentpole movie, obviously Denis Villeneuve's vision of Dune, the seminal and classic Frank Herbert novel. So, what is Dune House Secrets? Well, it's set, obviously, within the Dune universe. You're going to be taking part in this kind of mildly branching narrative story over four chapters. And these four chapters are the first in a planned trilogy. So this is the first game. There's another two games planned in the trilogy as well. And it's going to drop you into deep inside into this kind of web of intrigue within the Dune universe, using some of the characters you know from Dune and some that you may not know from Dune as well, as you work your way through these four chapters. The first one is the prologue chapter. And essentially, that's kind of a training wheels game, just gives you an indication of how the game plays, and then you have the story starting properly throughout the next three chapters, leading you to a conclusion. Now, it's set, as I say, in the Dune universe. Should we call that the Duneverse? I don't know. But also, it's based on Portal's own detective system as well. Now, I've never played any of the detective games, but I do know they are kind of these deductive reasoning where you're going to be given clues and red herrings and asked to solve cases, and that's what you kind of asked to do in Dune. Each of the chapters have some objectives, and you're asked to solve each of these objectives. And you're going to work your way through a number of variant kind of narrative cards, and one card may lead to another, or may give you things like resources, which you can get, which are these here, and you can get various things like water and spice resources. Or maybe you're going to have to kind of make some decisions and pull some of these tokens out of these bad, and they can have positive or slightly negative consequences for you. And as I say, it's almost a choose your own adventure style game over four chapters where you're going to make decisions that will kind of dictate-ish what happens to you next. And I'll come back to that ish in a wee while. There are four specific characters that you are given. We have Araya Koras, we have Javed Dahar, Daniel Arias, and Goran Malik, and you can see the cards here. And as a solo player, you're going to choose one of those characters and then flick the other three to the other side, and you get to get the benefits of whatever tokens they give you. And also in the game as well, there is a level up system, so you're going to get some stickers because you're potentially going to earn some experience points at the end of each chapter, apart from the final chapter, and that will allow you to gain some experience and potentially put stickers onto your player sheets if you want to. I didn't. I wrote it down onto a piece of paper because I didn't want to destroy the player cards or make it a legacy thing that nobody could play again. So, in an overview, you're dropped into a story that's web of intrigue and lies, and you're looking to do certain things. I'm not going to spoil the story here, through a mildly branching narrative to reach a conclusion using the cards that are given in front of you. Not just the narrative kind of event cards, but there's also these asset cards as well, which you'll pick up a number of throughout the game, as well as accessing the website that's been created to go alongside this, which will give you additional clues or things like history or film books, which may give you additional clues or some background information on some of the characters and kind of houses that you're coming across within the game. So it all sounds really, really kind of well woven together and exciting. And it's not. I'm going to kind of not bury the lead on this. There is absolutely no game here whatsoever. But before we get to why there is no game and there really isn't any game here whatsoever, let's just talk about the production values here, because the production values are genuinely very, very, very good. You see, for your £35, what you're going to get is you're going to get a fairly deep box. You can see the size of it there. Problem is most of it is empty, because all your housing in that box is a deck of cards this thick, a few maps, and a few tokens, and that's really it. And that's a little bit disingenuous there, because it doesn't need that size box. In fact, there's many things this game doesn't need. However, what you do get let's not talk about the value for money just yet. What you do get is all very well produced. You have some fantastic maps which are going to come your way, and these will be of Arrakis or Tel Gazir. You have these wonderful player boards which, you know, have a nice bit of background information about your particular characters on there. They're double-sided depending on how many you're playing. You have the various encounter cards. Now, these are all the encounter cards I went through during my total adventure, so that's not all of the encounter cards that are in the game, because of course you'll never get to experience every single encounter. You do get these asset cards as well, with some great artwork on there. And you also get this kind of sticker sheet for your leveling up and XP. And you get the tokens as well, which are all nice. And if you've got the pre-order like I did, you're going to get these wooden kind of these wooden tokens, these are your consequence tokens. You're going to pull those out, or pull random ones of those out at various parts in the game. Of course, that's not just everything as well, because of course you also get the web-based app as well, and that has some wonderful stuff in terms of the kind of the video books that you'll watch on there, and also in terms of the history and some of the animations on there and the backstory, all wonderfully well produced. And I think that's a really, really good thing that you're getting here, is you're getting a lot of kind of input for your game here. The issue being is almost all of it is completely superfluous. You see, what you've got here is a story that you're going to effectively play through, and we'll talk about how you play through in a second. And the story is well written. There's absolutely no denying that a lot of work has gone into the story. It feels like you've been dropped into this world of subterfuge upon Arrakis, where you're trying to kind of work with some of the characters there. And it is well written, but it feels a little bit, I don't know, like it's just dropped into the Dune world. It doesn't feel bespokely Dune. There are indicators in there, things like spice, and you'll come across some of the locations, like Gaedi Prime will be mentioned, and Arrakis, of course, that you'll know and love from the Dune world. But the story itself is away from the core concept of Dune, this geopolitical, huge or galactical political book, where this becomes a little bit of a whodunit. Now, within that is the issue itself, because at the beginning of every chapter, you're going to be given one of these sheets here. For example, we have these sheets for number one here. So the prologue one is in the box, but number one here, and it gives you a bit of backstory. So you watch a video on it, a little bit of backstory doesn't really tell you that much. Then you'll read the sheet, and then it will give you some mission goals. It'll tell you where to put your time track on the time marker. Here we have the board. Here we have the board for the time track. Across the top, you'll put your time track on there, and that literally tells you how many encounter cards you're going to get in that particular chapter. So if it's on number 9, then you're going to get 9 encounter cards, and you'll move that down every time you turn a counter card. And at the bottom, you have your consequence track as well, because at certain points in the game, you may be asked to pull out one of these tokens, and if it's green, it's okay. If it's red, then that's going to move you down on the consequence track, and that's going to affect your XP for buying your level ups at the end of each chapter. Sounds really exciting, but it really isn't. You see, once you've gone through this and you've read through this and you've set your time track up, it's going to give you some mission goals, and it's going to give you your starting encounters on there. And what you think you're going to do is work through this adventure, picking out the encounter cards, trying to achieve these mission goals. So at the end of it, when you get to the end and you've got your time track to the end, you can submit your status report. And you go into the status report, and it doesn't really reference these mission goals at all. It just maybe asks you a perfunctory question and you press yes or no, or you give it a bit of information about what you got, or maybe if you've got a couple of resources left over, you pay those resources to do something. And it's almost like everything that you were given at the beginning, all of this that you've gone through trying to get to these mission goals, means absolutely nothing. Nothing whatsoever. You see, the only real interaction that you have as a player in Dune House Secrets is occasionally on the encounter cards. Say it may ask you to draw a token, which will move you up and down on the consequence track. Or it may ask you to gain or discard some of these particular resource tokens. And you're going to do that. And that's really the gameplay. That's it. At the end of it, no matter how many, depending on how many on how high on the consequence track you are, you may get to level up your character. And that can be, you can get a smuggler or you can be a survivor. And for those, that's the kind of a one-time use, and you're going to either get a token or you're going to move the track up and down on there. Then you can go to level 2 and level 3. Makes no real difference whatsoever. The story, as well written as it is, feels very much on rails. The book even says you don't lose or win at this game. You just have a unique adventure, and the adventure is not that unique because your choices feel hamstrung. You feel like you're being kind of shifted towards one particular goal. Yes, at the end, you could potentially choose maybe 2 or 3 slightly different outcomes, but there is no real consequence to that as well. And the other thing is you've got your consequence track throughout the game. So on the first 3 chapters, you're going to be using the consequence track, which will dictate how much XP you got. On the final chapter, of course, you're not going to get XP. It's the final chapter. And therefore, they've got a victory point track, which is great, but it tells you that you don't lose or win the game. And therefore, that becomes absolutely pointless. There is no reason to have a victory point track on there. I finished it, I think, with 7 victory points on my playthrough. I don't know whether that's good. I don't know whether that's bad. It has no link into anything whatsoever. It feels like it's just thrown in there to try and give you an element of game. But there is no game here. What you have for your £35, you take away all of this really nicely produced stuff. What you have is a £5 choose your own adventure book. That's literally what you would get here. It's a novella. It's literally something that Van Ryder would produce for, I don't know, £8. I can get a copy of a 1,000-year-old vampire for cheaper than I played for this game, and that has endless replayability. This is one and done, and that's it. And the 4 chapters as well, let me tell you. So yes, you can play it 1 to 4 players, and obviously the more players that you have, then potentially the game will take longer. Each chapter took me about 30 minutes to play through. So for my £35 or £39, whatever I paid for this, I got just over two hours worth of gameplay out of it. And I say gameplay very, very loosely, because there is absolutely no game here whatsoever. I know it feels like I'm labouring a point when I say there is no gameplay here, but there isn't. For all of the wonderful maps that you get of Arrakis, and if you got the pre-order like I did, kind of all the different cards you can get for the various people, or the secret notes you can get, which will kind of give you advantages in various chapters, and you get this lovely folder with a certificate in there saying, hey, thank you for being back of 1099 on the pre-order, and you get this massive Arrakis map, and it's all utterly pointless because none of it means anything whatsoever. If you just got a little small novella book for £5 or £8, and it had you choose your own adventure in there, and you could keep track of the resources and the XP that you'd got at the back of the book, that would be far better value than what you've got here. But what you have here is a one-shot and done game that's going to take you 2 or 3 hours to complete the entire box for £35, and it's the first in a planned trilogy. I mean, that means, you know, if you want to continue this, you're going to have to spend over £100 to get the next, you know, to get all of the games in the trilogy. And it's utterly pointless because there isn't anything there to do. It's a lovely written story, and that is literally about it. There's nothing else here to do. It's based in the detective genre, if you like, so it's backed on detective. There is absolutely no deductive reasoning to do here. As I mentioned, the goals are almost arbitrary. It doesn't really matter what you do to try and achieve those, because when you get to the status report at the end, it's generally asking you a question that wasn't really directly related to those, which is a real shame. You don't feel like you have any agency. You don't feel like you are actually in control of anything. The gameplay is so kind of perfunctory, it's untrue. There is just, you know, to gain a token or lose a token or pull a consequence thing out of there. Really? Is that what we're doing in 2021? I mean, you know, you think of the wonderful depth of games that Portal does. Right? You think like Robinson Crusoe, which has got all the agency, and it's not trying to be Robinson Crusoe, I know that. But you think of everything that all the wonderful game designers do, and we've suddenly gone back to a fact that we're going to either gain a token or lose a token. It doesn't really matter that much. Or we're going to get this consequence out of there, or we're going to make one of two decisions on some of the cards. Same with these asset cards. You get these asset cards, it says do not look at them unless you're asked to. Most of them are just pictures. Most of them are just bloody pictures. So, you know, they're going to, here you go, you can get that picture of that. Go, look at that. Yeah, I'm not spoiling anything for anybody here because you'll not really know what that is about and it won't matter a jot to you when you actually get it. Some of them do have stuff on the other side and you have a look at that, but it's just all fluff to back up a decent story. Now, the work has gone in on the story, and as I say, as much as it feels kind of like a franchise too far, if you like. You know when a film takes it too far and suddenly it moves away from the core concept of the film, it keeps some of the same ideas. And so a sequel, if you like, that is not really as good as the first one. That's a little bit like here, and I'm not being unfair there because the story is well written, it's just not, obviously, you know, it's not Frank Herbert, and what is Frank Herbert? So the story is well written and it's engaging enough, but there is absolutely zero agency in you playing this game. There is no reason to have these large maps. There's no real reason to have these notes. You think you're onto a winner and not. There's no real reason to upgrade. And as I say, please, if you do get the game, don't use the sticker sheets. You can't use them again then. Just write it in your journal. It asks you to keep notes. And I did. I kept a wealth of notes in my notebook. And other than potentially keeping track of a couple of names, that was completely redundant as well. It's not a shame. I think, you know, they've advertised this as a game. It talks about it being a game on the back of it, a co-op game. It's not a game, it's an experience, and not a wholly satisfying one at that as well. You see, I posted it after online about, after I'd played the first prologue chapter, about how I was a bit iffy about it, and it wasn't really a game, it's more of an experience. And Ignacy Travacek from Portal replied to the post and said, you know, you're getting semantics here as to whether it's a game or an experience. If you enjoyed it, does it matter? Well, if that's the case, then for me it does matter. And I didn't really enjoy it. I enjoyed the writing, but I felt utterly cheated by everything else that was in here. It's all utterly pointless. And therefore, if it doesn't matter, why call it a game on the box itself? It's not a game. Why give me a box that is three quarters air? Why provide me with extra wooden tokens and a certificate and all this stuff that is completely unnecessary if it doesn't matter? If I'm, you know, if it doesn't matter whether it's a game or experience. No, you call this a game and it is not a game. It's a mildly nice story with zero player interaction that could have been released for significantly less money and potentially had more enjoyment from people. As it stands, it's a £35 giant white elephant. It's a bit of a emperor's new clothes here in the fact that it looks great and everybody might tell you that it's great, but there is nothing there. There really isn't anything there. You've got a nice story and that is it. So you may think I'm being unduly harsh on this because, of course, a lot of work has kind of gone into this in terms of the production values, in the website, in all of the artwork that's gone on here, in the assets that you get, in the designing of the maps, etc. And absolutely right, a lot of work has gone in there. It may seem a little unfair for me to say, for all these people that put that hard work in, hey, you know, I'm really knocking all of your hard work. But I want to look at it another way. Is that this is retailing for £30, £35, £39, whatever it is. There's a lot of people who are going to spend their hard-earned cash on this. And what they're getting is an experience that disappoints in almost every aspect. There is nothing here to justify what you're getting at the back end of it. It feels very much like those, you know, in the 80s, every movie had had some kind of weird cash grabbing. You know, there'd be an E.T. Frisbee for whatever reason. E.T. didn't play Frisbee. This is the modern equivalent of an E.T. Frisbee. There is a link there to Dune. There's a reason it's been released right now, but it all feels horribly rushed and just unnecessary. And I think that is the key thing. The wonderful website, all of that information in there could have been contained within a novella. All of this did not need to exist in a huge box with a massive plastic insert and wooden resources and certificates telling me I'm back at 1099 and massive maps of this. Because it's just perfunctory. It really is perfunctory. And it's a little bit of a shame that in this day and age that, you know, we feel that coming down to gameplay is just either giving or taking some tokens. So, a little bit briefer than my usual videos because there's not a great deal to say about the game. I think it's a huge waste of time. I think you could read the story and have a nice time doing that. Everything else really, really does not matter. I can't recommend this in any way, shape or form. I kind of see what they were trying to do, but to link it to something like Detective, which, you know, I'll say I haven't played, which has got all this deductive stuff, and then throw away any of the mechanisms from there, or seemingly throw away any of the mechanisms from there, to provide a £35 game, which is going to give you 2 or 3 hours maximum playtime, and let's use game very loosely, it just feels like it really, really shouldn't exist. So, from me, I really cannot recommend Dune House Secrets in any way, shape or form. Obviously, I will not be spending my money on getting part 2 and part 3 of this. I've done with this game and I can't recommend as a solo player and maybe even as multiplayers that you go out and buy this game. There is this game. There literally is nothing here other than a pretty nice story. Mine is just one opinion. Make sure that you go out and seek other opinions on this. If you're interested in the game, if you like the Detective series, then you may like what it has to offer. For me, it's the equivalent of an E.T. Frisbee. It just doesn't need to exist, and it feels like a bit of a rushed cash-in on a obviously big tentpole movie. So thank you very much for joining me on this journey. My name's Mark. This is Not Board Gaming. Don't forget you can like and subscribe to the channel. Check out our other videos. And one final thought. If you can't find anyone else to play with, there's nothing wrong with playing with yourselves. Until next time, bye-bye.